The History of the Jews, episode 4, I think. Can't remember. So many things to do. Okay, I've gone through how they sent out spies, two spies this time, to spy out the land of Canaan. And they met with Rahab, the prostitute. Yeah, and Rahab said, the whole city is afraid because they've heard of that you are coming for us, and they've heard of how the Lord gave you victory over the kings of the areas in the desert as they were marching around in Sinai. They met with other kings, and God has given them victory over all of them. So here they are coming after Jericho. Understand that Canaan, the land of the promised land, is not Canaan as a whole. It's called Canaan. But it's, you know, they have little states there with a ruler, with a king. There are many kings there. As we go through the book of Joshua, you will see the list of kings, like 20, 30 kings that he conquered in order to rid them of their land and seize it for the Jewish tribes. So here, Rahab helped them, and Rahab said, when you come, please spare me and my family. They said, yes, you know, put a red string on the door and make sure that all your families were inside the house. Otherwise, if they're outside the city, we're not responsible if they're dead. So that was what happened. So here is Joshua marching into battle. Now is the critical time. And we are told in Joshua that they have to cross the Jordan River. Understand that the promised land also it incorporates the land where they were as they entered. So some of the land is on this side of the Jordan River. The others is on the other side of the Jordan River. So this whole land is going to be divided among the 12 tribes. Each is to have their allotment, and they will have their own leaders in each lot, which we will go through. I will go through in Judges how, you know, when they were settled, what happened, how was the judging system works, how did it work. But we're at the moment where they're attacking Jericho to take the land. So Joshua, the instructions was the women and children were to stay on this side of the Jordan where they were, on the west side, I think. And those people whose land is on that side, they are not supposed to get it yet. The fighting men, will have to cross the Jordan to the other side to help their brothers fight for their land first. And until the brothers, the rest of them, got their land, they cannot come back to claim the land on this side of the Jordan. So it was, they have to cross the river again. It was at the time of harvest. Usually before the harvest, there'll be huge rain. For some reason, they need that huge rain to ripen the harvest fast, and the rain stops and the harvest. So this was at the time when it was raining, just before the harvest. And when it rains, the Jordan River swells up, rushing, flowing water, and they have to cross it. And the Lord said to Joshua, just step into the water. And the minute he stepped, the water stopped on one side, so there was dry land and they could walk through it. And after everyone had walked through, well, the Ark of the Covenant was in the middle. They were supposed to take stones, one stone for each tribe, to put in the center to make an altar. See, one of the thing about the altars to God is you just pick whatever stones is there and pile it up. You're not supposed to chip the stones so that it stacks nicely like the well-designed, constructed place. They're supposed to just take whatever there is, pile it up, and that's the altar to God, and very specific in the instructions. So, okay, here they are, and the instructions was we read about the fall of Jericho, how they march around and blew the trumpet and Jericho fell, and they went in to seize the land of Jericho. Again, Jericho is not one big city, Jericho. They're individual villages in there, with each with their own rules and rulers and what have you. So the whole area is enclosed by a wall, and the walls of Jericho fell, and the instructions was to kill every living thing, men, women, and children, and animals, and the valuables was to be belong to God, that they're not supposed to take anything, no plunder at all. That was the instructions. That was fine. And now they have to fight against a little place called Ai. Ai is tiny. So Joshua looked at it and said, okay, we don't have to send everybody there. It's so small, we can just send 3,000 people and that should take care of it. So they went and attacked Ai. What happened? They were defeated by Ai. It's like, how did that happen? They were defeated by Ai. Let me see what it says there. And I mean, Joshua couldn't believe it. Said, how did that happen? We took on bigger armies and were successful. Now we take this on this little place and we can't. So Joshua was very upset and sad, and yeah, he kind of sulked or something. He laid down and he said, Lord, why? What happened? And guess what God said to him? Get up. Why are you lying on your face like that? Israel have sinned and broken my covenant. They have stolen the things I commanded to be set apart for me. They have not only stolen them, they also lied about it, hiding the things among their belongings. Said, you will never defeat your enemies until you remove these things. Then the one who has stolen what was set apart for the destruction will himself be burned with fire along with everything he has, for he has broken the covenant of the Lord and has done a terrible thing in Israel. So now they know the reason why they had failure. Someone has taken the valuable things from that were supposed to be the Lord's. You're not supposed to take plunder that time. Someone has stolen the valuable things and hidden them. I said, I didn't do anything. I didn't touch anything. So that's why they had failure. So now the time has come to search for that family. Achan, it says Achan and his family. So they searched the tents to look for the loot and found it in his possession, Achan's possession. And what was the result? So then Joshua and all the Israelites took Achan, the silver, the rope, the bar of gold, his sons, daughters, cattle, donkeys, sheep, tent, and everything he had. And they brought them to the valley of Achor. Then Joshua said to Achan, why have you brought trouble on us? The Lord will now bring trouble on you. And you and all the Israelites stoned Achan and his family and burned their bodies. They piled a great heap of stones over Achan, which remains till today. And this was called the Valley of Trouble. So they have to excise the evil. See, think about it. When we sin, when we are Christians and we sin, we bring trouble on ourselves and on the church, on the nation, really. In the end, we will see the nations in uproar. Why do the nations rage? They're raging against good, against God, really, law and order. So now that they've cleansed the evil and excised it, they are now able to fight against Ai and receive the victory there that is due theirs. And for the Israelites, have very primitive thinking that success comes from the Lord, comes from obeying God, and ill will and misfortune comes from evil, from disobeying God. It's very simple. So they feel that, well, even to today, I don't know if it's still true. I'm sure it is, that we still attribute our failure to obey God. Somewhere, somehow in our lives, there is something that needs to be excised. And if we are honest enough, we can see it and and they can excise it and remove it from our lives and therefore receive the blessing of God. And then Joshua built an altar to the Lord on Mount Ebal. And Moses has written instructions on how to build the altar. Make me an altar from stones that are uncut and have not been shaped with iron tools. See, then the altar, on the altar, you present your burnt offerings and peace offerings to the Lord. And Joshua copied the law of Moses onto the stones of the altar. So that's how the instructions on building altars is. You're just stones. Don't use any instrument to cut or shape it. Just pile it on top, you know, rough hewn. And Joshua copied the law of Moses onto the stones. You know, usually with each victory, you write something on the stone and raise it up, you know, as a remembrance. And from these stones, you know, the primitive people in that area, not just the Jews do it, the Moabites and everybody. And from these stones, you know, with the inscription, we can see the writing. And that is a clue to how we know, how we learn about the ancient writing. You know, I didn't appreciate it before, but now I do. And I will next week come up with a posting on those stones and what valuable information they give us of the life there. Understand that the Bible was written to a people at that time. And in order to really understand it, and we must go back to their context and to their time and their culture, and therefore be able to draw out all this wonderful information that will add on to our knowledge and therefore deepen our knowledge and deepen our love for our God and His Word. I pray that this has blessed you. It is so important to love the Word of God. I will, if I have not prayed every day, that the Holy Spirit will impress upon me this desire for spiritual things, for the Spirit of God, to read His Word, to know Him better. And I pray that you will do the same too. We'll pray that the Spirit will empower you, that will give you that desire for spiritual things, the Word of God.